sahanavavatu sahano bhunaktu sahaviryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhidhamastu ma vidvishavahai om shanti 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 om yogena cittasya padena vacha malam sharirasya cha vaidyakena yopakarottam pravaram muninam padanjalim pranjaliranatosmi padanjalim pranjaliranatosmi om shanti shanti shanti. Shri Sadguru Maharaj ki jai. Om Namah Shivaya. The first section of introduction. Yesterday we were discussing about few things. One of them is this yoga philosophy is Sankhya based philosophy. And the another thing we discussed, the difficulties of an aspirant of modern time to study such textbooks like Yoga Sutra or Vedanta Sutras, Sankhya or other philosophies. So while discussing this, we were comparing some of the points related to science and our academical studies. So our thinking patterns are made in our schools and colleges. And some of the informations we get from our society. So today, the second section of introduction, I think it will continue for one or two more sections. So second section of introduction, we take up the points what we discussed yesterday little forward. I am taking up the subjects considering as if you are all beginners in yoga darshana. So because yesterday we understood how we can proceed, because there are many beginners. So the modern science counts the objects only. There is no relation with the subject. The subject, when I say, our mind, intellect, and self. So there is objective knowledge and subjective knowledge. There must be some connection with two. If there is no connection, it is very difficult or almost impossible to understand the creation. So science is lacking this. There is no connection of science and the subject, the experience we have, our own existence as. And the other thing, in these material objects, when they describe it, they take the comparisons and they connect the objects, material objects, or the created objects, comparing with energy and calculate with mass, charges, momentum, and all other things, you know that. It means they are just counting the outside objects. So in this case, we are in a problem to understand what is inside. There is no measurement or there is no charges you can put on that and understand. If somebody say there is self inside, we are ourself. We use this word very frequently, ourself, themself, yourself, myself. But what is this self all about? So there is no description. There is no research study on that. We use this everywhere. Without this, maybe this using the language and expression is impossible. We cannot say without taking this self a sentence or communicate something. So you have to take that. But this is something missing. So here we see in our philosophy, yesterday I was just mentioning this. There is a connection between two, the self and the outside objects. That is why these philosophical studies, especially you can see in our Yoga Sutra studies, it is a complete study. In the sense, it is taking the subject, the self, the mind, and intellect, and ego, whatever we experience very directly in our day-to-day life, and the thought process, it is very important. And then the material world, what we see outside. So they found some connection. So they tried to establish that connection through meditation, contemplation, doing research on that. So they could realize the material cause of the world, the efficient cause of the world, and all the manifestation, developments of the world, past, present and future. So they were very clear about this. And the result of that, we got these Yoga Sutras. And Swamiji says in his mantras and meditation, Swami Vishnudevananda Maharaj, he says, the Yoga Sutras is the most comprehensive scientific approach to realization. Why? Because it takes both sides. It is talking on both sides, subjective and objective. And Patanjali was the greatest physiologist we have ever seen. Rather, we can say he was the first philosopher to establish physiology in these terms very elaborately, very, very elaborately. So he could see the infinite possibilities, the ultimate possibility of the mind, intellect. Now we have a problem. You know what is it? You know about auto-suggestion. So I have seen here the word is used in that yoga posture calendar that is there. In psychology, there are two types of suggestions. One is auto-suggestion, we know. The other is hetero-suggestion. Auto-suggestion and hetero-suggestion. Auto-suggestion, you know, self-suggestion. And hetero-suggestion comes from others. It is coming from society, it is coming from the education, it is coming from others. Now, we are living in a world of hetero-suggestion. We are not living for ourselves. We are not for ourselves. But we want everything for us, for ourselves, but our lifestyle and practices is not the same, the connecting with the object. Our object is we want complete satisfaction. But our practices are not correlating with the aim. It is something else. Why? Because we are following this hetero suggestions. Now we say there are lifestyles, the lifestyles changes. Who is changing the lifestyle? The society changes, then we change into that. And we are living in a world of terrorism. We are living in a world of war. And we are always having fear, fear, fear everywhere. Why it is happening? It is our society, we made this society. Because we are following this hetero-suggestion, it is coming from outside and we can't change it. Because this change should happen within. There is no way to go within and find the reason to change it. Find the way to change it. We are living in the world of formalities. We are living in the world of formalities. When I say everything what we do, we want to be formal. And another word we say manners. There are so many types of manners, table manners, family manners, official manners. So everywhere there are manners. What are these manners? It's all suggested by the society. So when you analyze your life, you take one day, during the day, what you do? You just follow these suggestions. So you have to wake up in the morning and do all these things and brush and bath and all this. So one by one when they say. And when you go to office for your business, everywhere you follow this, you have no chance to think of yourself. You always think of outside, how they feel, what they feel. So this is the big trouble, or rather I say it is conflict within. We want something else and we are doing something else. There is no connection. This is why we cannot easily understand when Yoga Sutra says about inner spheres, inner realms of the mind and understanding. Okay? So, this is one thing that we want to connect both the inner self and outer world. I mean to say, we are not going to change outer world. We are going to change ourselves. If we change ourselves, the world is changed. You know how? Swami Vishnudevananda ji, he tried his best to bring peace to the world, to the universe, by yoga and meditation. There is a secret that you will learn subsequently how it is possible. Only yoga and meditation can bring peace in the world, no other way. Why? Because the change should happen within. You cannot change the world unless you change yourself. Now, how can we change ourselves? So we have to understand this. What is happening with us? First, we have to understand. If we want to change ourselves, we have to understand what is happening inside our minds. What is happening in our intellect? What is the relation between society and ourselves? how this world is created for us and how this world is changing, if there is any change in the world, how it is happening. So these things we have to understand. Only when you go within, you can understand this. If you change yourself, then world is changed. What is society? Society is personalities, the individuals. So if one individual change, they change into a positive level, then the whole society is changing into positive level. This is the relation between yoga and the individual and the society or the universe. So this aspect we have to remember when we study Yoga Sutras. So now, what is our first duty? We want to change ourselves or we want to change the society? What is first? Now you understood. I want to change myself. Okay. The problem arises there. You may ask the questions when you get the chance. When I want to change myself, I cannot change because the society doesn't allow me to be changed. I cannot live in a society with this sort of thinkings and practices because society wants something else. If I go to office, I cannot practice this. I cannot practice meditation there or yoga there or even the philosophy. What the yoga says, I cannot practice that in the office and society. That is what you are going to say. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. There is a way to do that. So what is this? You keep your mind busy. You keep your mind busy. How? Thinking about harmony, good health, peace, and always try to keep goodwill towards others. So you keep on and you repeat this, and then you see the change in within you and outside. Because when thoughts changes, everything changes. If you don't change your thoughts, you think, oh, it is not possible, it is, how can I do that? Then there is no way. First you have to remove this precondition that it is impossible to live in this world with all these philosophies. So if you remove that, you can see the wonder that is going to happen in this world. Now, the connection with the yoga and Sankhya, we will look at that, how yoga and Sankhya is connected and what Sankhya says and what yoga says. I'm introducing this point elaborately, the discussion will come when we take up the sutras and learn. Yoga and Sankhya has a similarity. That is, the metaphysics of Sankhya and yoga is the same. And the theory of creation, theory of creation of this world, creation, is the same. What Sankhya says, yoga accept that is the same. And all the basic principles like consciousness, nature as prakriti, intellect, and it develops into ego, and it develops into sense organs, all these theories. This will also be discussed later. So the principles are the same. Only the difference is yoga has accepted the God, Supreme Lord, as one of the principles. In this, Sankhya doesn't accept God as a principle. God is a part of consciousness itself. And both these philosophies are dualistic philosophies. Dualistic philosophy. It is not non-dualistic like Vedanta. Here, the ultimate truth, ultimate reality, there are two ultimate realities. That is one consciousness, another is material cause. That is, we can say, the potential state of material cause. That we say matter in science. So the matter and consciousness, the two things exist. They say Purusha and Prakriti. Purusha is consciousness, pure consciousness. And Prakriti is matter in the state of potential state. So it means the potency of creation. So that is why this philosophy, two philosophies, both Sankhya and Yoga, are dualistic philosophies. And now the another difference. Sankhya uses reasoning or knowledge for realization. They give much importance to reasoning or knowledge. While yoga is more into the path of sadhana and meditation. Physical practices, mental practices, yoga philosophy, Patanjali yoga darshana gives more importance to that. Therefore we can say the philosophy of yoga, metaphysics of yoga is Sankhya, but sadhana is different. The sadhana is elaborated here. In many ways it is elaborated. So, these are the similarities and dissimilarities. Basically, we discussed this. And what are the principles and how the Sankhya metaphysics works with yoga, this we will discuss afterwards. Now you know the world, this yoga is most widely practiced exercise. There's a new study say every sixth person of the world is practicing yoga. The recent study they found out. Every sixth person is practicing yoga. It means something wonder. So you all get so much of joy. You are going to get so much of joy with this, because you have to teach others. No? And 20 million Americans, they are practicing yoga. And among them, 77.1% are women. So here also we can see the students are more. And 22.9% men. So you see the development, how it happens. Because it is practically working, practically happening. The changes are happening. But with this change, there is little problem. Problem is what is, so we are talking about this philosophy. If I talk more than 1 hour, you are going to sleep. Because it is too difficult to understand. I am taking it very slowly, taking it up the subject very slowly because I want to bring your mind into this subject and make what is the perfect thinking about that, correct thinking about that. So it will take some time. Now we are analyzing the problems, what is happening. Why am I taking all these problems? I don't want the problem to come in between when I start the subject. Because the questions arise from these problems. So I am giving you the tool or even the weapon, you can say. So I am giving you the problem first. You take it and understand when you think about something related to yoga, so why it is happening. Because the question comes from this problem. You have this problem, so it is coming from there. So when the question comes, you just think back, what is happening in your mind? What is happening in my mind? How this question is coming? It is because of my ignorance, or because of my social relation, because of my personal life, because of my family life, or because of my lack of practice. You can see that. Although the yoga is practiced in this way, but the problem is now yoga is synonymous with asana and pranayama. There is no yoga philosophy is practiced. And I say it is oversimplified, too much simplified. Only you practice this, you will get everything. That is what they say. Now you will see in this Patanjali Yoga Darshana while studying this, how deep it is. How deep it is and how much effort you have to do for it. To just get into the real state of yoga. So when you simplify it, it is good. For a beginner, you have to make it simple, easy, practicing. It is necessary. But now we are staying only in that step. We are always in a stage of beginner. So this makes again obstacles that we cannot proceed. There is no going up. The asanas we can see that it is for the beginners according to the Yoga Sutra, asana, pranayama and all the ashtangas. For beginner. After that, you have to take it up. Go forward. And understand more about mind and intellect and ego. We say it is antakkarana. So, inner organs or inner senses. Sense organs we have outside and inner. So it is very difficult. In this case, we have to do much effort to change this impression. That is, yoga means asanas and pranayama. You have to go a little further. And you have to make a yogic culture based on this philosophy. This Patanjali yoga, darshana philosophy, or even hatha yoga darshana philosophy, you have to make a culture like that. You have to change it. When you teach asanas and pranayama, you have to remember that these teachings are the basics of yoga philosophy. The very, very basics. I have to teach more on that. Then you will find the change, the real change. The personality changing, or the with that the society is also changing. If you only teach this much, asanas and pranayama, from that you cannot see a big change, what you want to be. But I say in this stage, even asanas and pranayama will give some result. I am not negating it. There are results, we are experiencing the result. Because after practicing asanas and pranayama, he is cool, the person is cool. And you cannot see a person in violence or doing something wrong as a yogi. It means he is practicing yoga and going for violence. No, you will not find a person in the world like that. It is a true. There was a study on this. Even a single person, you cannot find if he is doing some violent terrorism or whatever. He is not a yoga practitioner. The yoga practitioner cannot do that. It will not happen from his side or her side. It is a wonder. That is what I said. When Swamiji says, we can change the world with yoga practice, and we can bring peace to the world by yoga practice. That is very true. This is a study shows that. That is true, that is happening. But I am saying something else. When we take the philosophy correctly, the methodology of practice correctly, then the result and the ultimate aim is achieved. That is my intention to say that. So if you don't take the philosophy and the correct practice, the aim is not achieved in your lifetime. So only you maintain your body and you in good health and good mind and the energy and everything is there. But you will miss something. You will feel that I am missing something. I have to achieve this. Something is missing. So that is why this will help you to form that mind of practice and with a real philosophy. What is what yoga says. Huh? Now you see the board here. We put the board yesterday, which we are today we are trying to enter into this. So this the subject of attraction in Yoga Sutra. So when we discuss Yoga Sutra, when we study Yoga Sutra, these are the subjects specially discussed. You will understand, you will get some answer for this. Subjects. Look at this. First, mind and the creation relationship. If there is any relation between mind and creation, and if any, what is it and how is it? You know what is creation. What is creation, you know? Creation, when you say this outside creation. Outside creation is also a creation, and this body is also a creation. Body is also created, and outside world is also created. So when I say creation, you have to remember this. It should be noted. When I say creation in all my lecture, you have to take both, including physical body. Because always we look at outside when we say creation. So creation is both. Now mind, how mind is related to this creation? You see, you know that one desire comes to your mind. You think upon that for some time. The desire, any of these normal desires. You want to achieve something, you want to do something, you want to act on something anyway. After that, what happened? You continuously repeat that desire, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do it this way and that way, and you try to find ways how to fulfill that desire, how to act on that. Okay. So when you repeatedly think, accordingly, body adjusts with that. Body changes itself. So how it happens? Because when you think something repeatedly, when the desire is strong and stronger, the brain works accordingly. This is physiology, it's purely physiological. Physiological terms. Brain works accordingly. And not only that, brain gives suggestions to the body, to the elements of the body, to the senses, that this desire should be fulfilled. So you create so much energy in this body. This is the suggestion brain gives directly to the body and senses. You got it? This is the first step, huh? Then after that, what happens? After body gets the suggestion, body changes its chemicals and it changes its energy and make new cells and make new energy cells, create new energy to act on that. The body do a long preparation for that action. This is a wonder how it happens. And then after some times you feel that, oh, I can do that. I have this ability, I can do that. So then the communication with the brain and body is completed. Once it is completed, you are ready for action. Then the action happens. It's a very simple process, procedure. It's a step-by-step procedure. Now you see, I'm just giving an example. We'll elaborate it more when it comes to the sutras. So you see, the body is also a creation. And when mind gives the suggestion, body act accordingly, then body takes the energy. From where the energy comes? This is another question. But because body needs energy to act according to the desire. Because the brain already gives suggestion to make body ready for this particular action. From where the body gets the energy? Body gets the energy from food, from water, from the air, oxygen. These are the main sources of energy. Now you see, first the suggestion, from the thought of desire, then comes the suggestions in the brain, then the body is trying to prepare itself, then it takes the energy from outside. It needs food and all this. You can see the relation, how it goes. Now there is a communication. There is a subtle communication which we don't feel. There is a communication with the outside elements and the body. And body try to find those elements in the creation outside and take the energy for itself to prepare this, fulfill this desires. It's a wonder. And it goes on, if that desire is not fulfilled in this body, in this birth, you may be having so many desires that is impossible to fulfill in this birth. Mind keep it in its storage. That is, we say memory or something else, the samskaras, impressions, habitual impressions and that. So it keeps it, and when it gets the chance, again it coming into the action, or jump into the action and take the result there. Because once this suggestion is made, it is the duty of mind and body and the elements in the body to fulfill that suggestion of brain. This is what is happening in our body. If you give a bad suggestion, a negative suggestion, that I cannot do this, I am unable to do this, this is also a suggestion. So then what happened? The just opposite. The energy is lost, you feel tired, and you cannot do anything. So slowly you are going back. So you give the suggestion very strong, I can do it, I want to do it. Then you are fit for that action, and that body and mind get connected. This is only one example I gave for this mind and creation relationships. In this Yoga Sutra, very, very obviously it is discussed, and with the step-by-step process, the all creation theory of Sankhya is based on this, the first thing, how mind can create this world. Okay, it will be very interesting to know. And the second point, the consciousness, subconsciousness, unconsciousness, superconsciousness, all in the mind. This is in the terms of psychology, we say conscious mind. So mind which is acting, which is practically empirical mind, which is practically acting. That is conscious mind. The subconscious mind, behind the acting mind, practical mind, it gives suggestions and take care of the conscious mind, take care of the body, so on. Okay? Then unconscious mind is the source of conscious mind and subconscious mind. It is the storage of everything. What is there in unconscious mind, you will not know. But the energy source or the suggestions come from unconscious mind. It is completely in an unmanifested form. There is no link that you can connect to unconscious mind. only you can see the effect coming out of it. Only you can see through subconscious mind, unconscious mind. That is, we have a infinite source of energy in this unconscious mind. It can create many, many lives, many, many births. There is so much of information stored there, the storage place of informations. The new psychology is now just they started doing research on that. Only till now they could understand subconscious mind, how it works. Now they just trying to enter into unconscious mind, what is that? Okay, because we have here the definition and everything that we will see what is that. And superconscious mind. Superconscious mind is a complete development of the mind. So it controls the conscious mind, subconscious mind, unconscious mind, everything. Superconscious mind can only be developed by practicing deeper, deeper meditation with the samadhi. So this superconscious mind is the yogi's mind. So he knows everything. He uses conscious mind, subconscious mind, unconscious mind. He can enter into that and he knows everything. That is why we say superconscious mind or ultra-cognitive mind. So any word we can use there. It's a special mind. After practicing a long, long meditation, you find this energy there. So it is something special. And these are the infinite possibilities of mind. The mind, when we take the unconscious mind itself, there is infinite possibilities. We have to develop that. You know, normally only 10% of our brain is activated. So we are using only 10% of the brain. The 90% is not used normally. If you are a scientist, you are contemplating or thinking more on the subjects, deeper into the subject, then you may use like up to 20%. That is what they say. So what about this 80%? Is it useless? Why it is there? What is the use of that 80% brain? Till today, scientists do not know why this 80% brain is there in this body. They don't understand why it is there. And whatever extra fittings are there in this body, it is sometimes useful. So they found out each and every organ in the body is useful. You know, we have how many organs in the body? You are all yogic practitioners. I remember that 78 organs. Organs, we say, there is a definition for organ. The many cells work for a single purpose. Many cells together work for a single purpose is called organ in the body. The 78 organs are there. So out of that, one is brain. Okay. So now they know all other organs, they are useful in certain conditions. All other organs are useful. But what about brain? They don't understand. Why this 80% or more than 80% is useless? We are not using it. What is the need of that? So that is the infinite possibilities. And this, in this Yoga Sutra, Maharshi Patanjali tried to use that part of brain. So he will teach us how to use that. We are going to use that. Only with samadhi practice, we say samadhi prajna, the intellect developed from samadhi or with samadhi. That is called samadhi prajna. It's a word used in Yoga Sutra itself. The intellect developed by practicing samadhi is called samadhi prajna. By this samadhi prajna, by this intellect, the special intellect, you can use the other part of the brain. And when it can connect to the senses, can connect to the body, can connect to that. So you know, if you are in your laptop, there is so much memory left. You are not using. You will feel, no, I have to store this thing, that thing. Can store more music, store more films and things like that to fill that. Why? Because it is not using, it is waste. It is a waste actually. So you have so much of memory, so much of brain that is not in use. So Patanjali will show the way to use it. That is infinite possibilities of the brain, mind. And now deep sleep, dream sleep analysis. How sleep happens, why there is a need for sleep, and what is deep sleep. So we can learn much from our sleeping. We are daily going to sleep. There is to learn some philosophy, something from that. It's an indication. There is an indication for our own development. So something is there, some reality is there. So we will learn that. Deep sleep and dream sleep. Dream sleep at another stage of mind where the subconscious mind works directly and produces some pictures, some experiences there. That is dream sleep, you know. And you know that dream sleep is not in our control. Dream sleep is not in our control. Why? Because you want to see a sweet, good dream, but it is not possible. Whatever comes to your dream, you have to accept it and experience it. It is good or bad, you cannot change it. It is out of your control. It is happening in your mind, in your body, but it is out of your control. So we learn something from that, because subconscious mind is working there, and subconscious mind is not directly controlled by conscious mind. That is why we cannot control the sleep. We cannot give any suggestions to sleep. If you want to control the sleep, dream sleep, if you want to control the dream, you have to practice something. So we will discuss that. What are the practices? How can we change the subconscious mind? And mystery of death. So death is a fear. If you ask what is fear, fear is death. Death is fear, fear is death. So we try to analyze what is death. Is there any death or not? If you understand that, then there is no fear. The fear is gone. So we will understand that mystery of death. What is death? If it is happening to body or mind or what? So this way we will try to understand. And connected to that, karma and rebirth. Meanwhile, you must have understood from the first point itself how the rebirth is possible, why it is possible. Because it is connected. The rebirth is only to the body. There is no rebirth for mind, for intellect, for the unconscious mind or subconscious mind. There is no rebirth. It is only one birth. It takes to all the bodies. So we will scientifically find out how this is possible. What is the connection with the karma and rebirth? I already gave you the secret of the karma and rebirth, giving the example of mind-body reactions. Okay? So there are more points. I think this is the time to stop here. Though we complete this section by this, and we will continue it in 9:130. Om Purnamatah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudasyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti.